What's going on, Reef Builders? I'm Jake Adams coming back to you from the Reef Builder studio. Today, we're gonna talk all about the different types of flower pot corals. We have learned so much about this group of corals that once used to be impossible to keep, but today I'm gonna share with you what I know about them and the three broad groups of them. But before we get started, if you are not yet a subscriber, go ahead and subscribe and hit that notification bell. And later on in the video, if you enjoyed it, make sure to hit that thumbs up button. So there's three different types of flower pot corals. There's a lot of species, but there's three broad groups. For the longest time, the main group was Goniopora. And so right behind me is four different Goniopora, a little bit more classic flower pot corals. Another one that was split off from the group only about 4 or 5 years ago is called Bernardpora. I'm gonna show you a couple of those. And another group, which once was thought to be related to these other two, has completely been splintered off. This is the Alveopora. So there's Alveoporas, they're still Alveopora, but now we know that they have nothing to do with flower pot corals, although their care is quite similar. So behind me are four different Goniopora, right? These are kind of the classic strains. These are all frag grown. Very, very important, and that's gonna be important at the end, and I'm gonna explain why. I grew all of these from frags. They don't necessarily have names. In the middle is the Amazeballs goni, and despite the light level being quite low in this aquarium, I'm having a little bit of challenge getting that one to really contrast with this gold polyp stalks and its yellow-orange tentacles. And then behind there is kind of, it's a broad group of kind of highlighter green types of Goniopora. This is one of the best starter Goniopora. It gets really long polyp stalks and is incredibly flowy. This, for the longest time, the red flower pot corals, especially the red gonies, particularly the Ore red goni, was one of those strains that we could count on to survive in our aquariums, probably because it was frag grown, and that's gonna be important at the end of this video, and I'll explain at the end. So this is a really cool strain I picked up at Reef Palooza probably almost 3 years ago, and it's kind of got a really nice, neat, blue-colored interior. And this is kind of what you would generally call a rainbow goni because it has the red pink polyp stalks and the kind of bright yellow polyp tentacles, right? So the longest part is not the tentacles themselves, it's the polyp stalk. And then at the very end with all the extra hands or extra tentacles, those are the actual polyp business end. And we'll move over to Bernardpora and Alveopora and try to show you the difference. You wouldn't know it by looking at this coral, and I can barely tell by looking at this coral that this is actually not a Goniopora. This is a Bernardpora corals. And there are three ways that you can kind of distinguish them. First of all, when these guys are frags, the polyps stay really short. Some strains are sometimes called like an encrusting flower pot coral, but as they get larger and in a lower or gentler flow environment, their polyps can get really long, and it takes a really good look at them. You really have to like inspect them to try to tell the difference. But one of the things that I'm figuring out that is different about the Bernardpora versus the Goniopora is in Goniopora, the polyp tentacles are so much more rounded at the very tip, very rounded. Whereas these guys, the polyps actually kind of come a little bit more to a finer point, right? So they have a lot less of a lobe to them. They can be rounded, but they're never gonna be as globular at the end of the tentacle as you would find in a typical classic Goniopora. Now, this guy has only been in this tank for about 2 to 3 weeks because I didn't really recognize, this is also one of my first times having good success with flower pot corals in general. I didn't really recognize that when the Bernard pora got bigger and the polyps got longer, it would actually sting the flower pot corals. So very much like Euphyllia, you can group almost all of them together except the torch corals. Same thing with the flower pot corals. You can group pretty much all the Goniopora corals, but not the Bernard pora, because at first when they're frags, it's okay, it's all hunky-dory, but once the colony settles in, the Bernard pora will get much longer tentacles and get much more aggressive about fighting a space. So again, this is another frag that I purchased right around 3 years ago. It's grown really, really well for me. So let me show you another Bernard pora. So this is another Bernard pora strain. In this example, you can see how much smaller the polyps themselves are. It encrusts really well. This is something I didn't really mention so much, because you can't really see the colonies of Goniopora when they're thriving. You just see tentacles, right? But when you get them closed up, flower pots are gonna tend to be a lot more submassive, so like almost round, but kind of melting onto whatever they're growing onto, whereas these guys will encrust. And this one is a particular strain that has been grown in captivity for, I'm guessing, like 10, 15 years, so a really, really long time. This is a very common strain, pretty much all red with a yellow mouth. So the one before had kind of the yellow tentacles. This one has a yellow mouth. But if you find this at your local fish store, this is gonna be a pretty easy flower pot coral to get into. And then if we slide back just a little bit further, we have the very superficially similar Alveopora corals. Main thing that we use to differentiate between the Alveopora and the Goniopora is Goniopora pretty much is going to have too many tentacles for you to count. If you're looking really closely, it's going to be about 18 to 24, but the Alveopora is pretty much locked in at 12 tentacles. So that is one of the easiest way to tell them apart. Also, the Alveopora, they tend to be more branching and kind of amorphous, and the tentacle lobes themselves will be a little bit expanded. So anytime you see some of those really flower-looking polyps on a flower pot coral, it's generally going to be Alveopora. So back in the day, we used to think that these guys were closely related to Goniopora, but new molecular analysis has actually revealed that these are more closely related to the Monopora that we have here in the aquarium. So I actually had these in a higher energy different system, and since I've kind of put them off to the corner here, they have absolutely blossom. Like, they were doing okay before, but now they're really, really crushing it. We've got a kind of a light minty green version with really flowery looking polyps. This is the same variety. You can see in the shade, a little bit more shade. The polyps are just a little bit more lush, a little bit more filled in. And this is actually a light pink version that is probably the same species as this one. And, you know, I don't know the differences between Alveopora species. I can highlight a few of the different Goniopora species. There's only one species, a Bernard pora, thank goodness. But the Alveopora, I mean, to be honest, this is all like new territory for me. You know, I've never had success across the board with all these corals before. So the general care for these corals is probably a lot easier than most of us think. Most of them are gonna prefer low to medium flow with perhaps a programmed blast of water flow once or twice or throughout the day to really get them whipping. And same thing with the light. Low to medium light. There's certain types of Goniopora flower pot corals that you can find in really shallow water, but in those environments, the polyps are actually not quite as fully extended. For most flower pot corals, I would definitely, like so many other corals, advise you to start them with a little bit lower light intensity and gradually build them up to some kind of medium level of light strength. About feeding. I find, and I think a lot of successful flowerpot coral people will agree, that a higher nutrient tank is definitely gonna be more suitable for these corals, and gets a little bit more critical for these guys. They come from pretty turbid environments, which are, again, medium flow, medium light, but with a lot of dissolved organic matter in the water. So if you really wanted a flower pot tank, I wouldn't advise you to not have a skimmer altogether, but maybe to have either an undersized protein skimmer, or have your skimmer go off some part of the day, or only come on for like 6 to 12 hours a day, so you can preserve some of the organic material in the water. So what if you can't provide that specific form of filtration? The smallest particulate food is what they want. Nothing larger than just the almost the powderiest, the most powdery coral foods that are available on the market. And we're gonna wrap up this video by actually feeding these corals a little target feeding. There is one species of Bernard pora. Generally, it's gonna be red, very shades of red, sometimes with a blue base, sometimes with yellow tentacles, sometimes with yellow mouth. But Bernard pora, kind of one group to work with. Alveopora, similar picture, where most of them are gonna more or less kind of look the same, but in the Goniopora, there's an incredible, incredible variety. Even within the reds, you can have a metallic red, you can have a light pink, you can have a mauve, you can have a lavender purple. The lavender purple is a species called Tenuidens. People overlook that one a lot because it'll be $20 instead of $100. But man, if you see some of the bluish gray Goniopora, go ahead and snag yourself a frag, because those things do very, very well. But also in the rainbow category, there's all different, so much small, minute diversity that we haven't teased out from the flower pot corals the same way that we have with, let's say, Monopora or Acropora, where we get down to what is the color of the nodule, what is the color of the polyp, what is the color of like one polyp tip coming off of it. So one variety that I don't have in my care right now, was really, really cool, and it was the Australians who turned me onto this. It's called a Glitter Goni or a Sparkle Goni. I think the Glitter name has taken over a little bit more from Sparkle, and these are really, really neat. If you look at this guy, the polyp stalks are incredibly smooth, kind of like the same color throughout, but the Glitter Gonis, which can come in yellow, green, pink, and red, they have like the, almost like a fleck, like this weird little fleck, multiple flecks all throughout the polyp, all throughout the stalk. So a really, really, really cool variety. And I even have a branching purple Goniopora. It's not doing its best right now, but it's actually coming back from some stresses that I wasn't able to identify. So two of the main takeaways I want you to really grab from this video is that slightly dirtier water, a slightly more nutriated water, that is really, really gonna fuel your flower pot growth. And some intermittent target feeding is also really, really gonna help. But I wanna give credit to someone who was pioneering the flower pot corals long before anyone else. Just incredible. I think the first presentation I saw from him was IMAC in like 2007, and he was talking all about flower pots and keeping them, and at the time I just barely believed him. But one of the things that he said was flower pot corals grow so much better from frags. And I can tell you from my medium amount of experience that all of my successful Gonis, Alveopora and Bernard pora, are all frag grown. And I think part of the reason for that is flower pot corals come from kind of dirtier, turbid environments, which attracts a lot of boring creatures like feather dusters, boring sponges, boring clams. And so if you just get a colony straight from the wild, or you see a colony at the fish store, there's probably a lot of stuff growing in the skeleton. And the skeletons of flower pot corals are very porous. They are among the lightest of all coral skeletons that we have in the aquarium hobby. So I think the process of fragging these corals into smaller pieces and cutting off the base separates healthy tissue from some of those biofouling encrusting critters that would grow in the skeleton of the coral. It makes a lot of sense. Some colonies come from really clean environments, but I would highly advise you that if you have any kind of new flower pot corals, definitely keep an eye on them. Definitely check the base, because a lot of stuff can take time to grow up through the skeleton and really cause some damage to the entire colony. So, with that, I think it's time to do a little target feeding. I mentioned previously that you want to use the finest particulate food possible. And I've gone ahead and pre-soaked some Brightwell Reef Blizzard S. You can see it right here. I like to pre-soak my food so it's like completely hydrated and saturated. So we actually have the pump flow off, but not the return pump flow off. So I'm gonna turn the return pump flow off, and we're gonna give these corals a nice treat. I think in general, you probably just wanna broadcast feed the entire tank, or really, if you really wanna do flower pots, consider what I said about having kind of a little bit dirtier water. Not leather coral dirty or shroom coral dirty water, but just a little bit more juice in the tank for them to enjoy. So the flow is completely off. Gonna go ahead and grab some of this food. There's a lot of great coral foods on the market. I really like Reef Blizzard because they specifically grade the particle size, small, medium, large, and then A, which is for anemone. So that's like even extra, extra large. And that makes it really easier to give the corals what they really, really need. And yeah, we're just gonna let it fall on the coral polyps right there, kind of spread it around, and you'll see the individual polyps just kind of retreat slowly as they start sucking up this food. So that's about everything I think I know about flower pot corals in general. I am not super sure how these corals went from very hard to keep to growing really, really quickly, but I think that the fragging culture in the reef aquarium hobby and community has really benefited this group of corals. So if you're looking to get some flower pot corals, whether it's an Alveopora or a Bernard Pora, or the Goniaporas that are so much more common, definitely look out for the frags more than the colonies. So I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, make sure to give it a thumbs up. If you have any questions that I didn't address here in this video, go ahead and put those down in the comments down below, and we can have a nice discussion and conversation about them. Thank you so much for watching this video. We'll catch you on the next one.
think of you as a glorified SPS. You belong to the family or a today. That should be a giveaway.
Your heart still needs, what do you eat?
Tiny foods I can hardly see.
Strooch.
Family born today, that should be a giveaway.